strategies. So they talked about seller financing or owner financing where the properties are owned free and clear. There's basically 4 out of 10 houses in the United States are owned free and clear.
Wow.
And so that's a strategy where you go and you negotiate your mortgage rate with the homeowner and the price with the homeowner. And that's where, if you're just buying for yourself or buying as a rental property, the lease options are huge, because a lot of people that are in the creative financing, what was interesting as they were listening to John Jackson speak and some of the other guys that have experience with lease purchasing and lease options, is they realize that that's actually, they think of it as only like, oh, that's a short-term, you know, assignment deal. You get in and out. But the reality is, if you do a lease purchase with someone, you can do the long-term lease purchasing. It can turn into a creative financing deal, like a wrap or a sub-2 agreement for sale, land contract, that type of stuff too.
Yeah. This is the time to learn the different strategies of creative real estate. We're going back to old school now. Okay, the lease purchase is wonderful because it's leverage. You can control a property by renting it and having an option. An option means a choice to buy it or not buy it. If you do your contracts correctly, and I have a lot of contracts in my books, by the way, if you do your contracts correctly, you can live in the property yourself if you need a home for yourself. You can rent it out for, hopefully you're paying, if you're paying the owner $2,000 a month and you can rent it out for $2,800 or Airbnb it or something, you make yourself $800 or more per month. You can sandwich lease that property. So if you are paying $2,000 a month, you can rent it out for $2,500. If you can get option money, that's an option to purchase it. That's a special payment that they make upfront. Your contract should have it non-refundable. So you get cash upfront, not a security deposit, which you can get in addition, by the way, but you can get this non-refundable option money for creating this opportunity for what we call a tenant buyer to buy the property. So you're making money upfront. You're making money every month. If they buy the property, let's say you have a 3-year contract and they buy it in the first year, hopefully you've increased the price. So you make a money out of, you make money out of escrow. So, and you can let the contract expire. You can renegotiate it with the owner if the market gets worse. You can buy it for your own portfolio. You can do all these different things, but you don't have to pay the mortgage and the taxes, and you don't have the legal liability because you're still a tenant. In most cities, who's the most protected person? The tenant, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. And my mentor used to always say, tenants are smarter than real estate investors. So if we can negotiate a lease with an option, we have all these different ways to control the property and profit without the, and we don't, if the roof leaks, who has to fix it? The investor or the owner of the property that you're leasing from?
The owner.
The owner.
The owner.
So you don't have to repair the roof or replace the hot water heater. So it's so many, and this is coming back. I got started because eventually you run out of money and credit when you're a real estate investor, especially in a high price market. So this is leverage. This is leverage type investing, which is wonderful. Brandon also spoke about owner financing. When you have an owner who has a free and clear property. So you get an owner, you buy a property from an owner, they're paying 4%, you give them 6%. And one of the more technical aspects of real estate investing is called a wrap. So you sell the property or lease purchase it and you increase the interest rate to set, let's say 8, 9, 10%. So now you're making interest like a bank does on the overall sale price of the property. Talk about some of the strategies you learned there, Brandon.
So, well, I've been doing a lot of these things for a while, thanks to you, Claude. And what's interesting is a lot of these strategies, it was kind of fun because there's some older gentleman in there, right? And he's like, I waited 14 years for this. It's coming back, you know? And as we're going on a downturn where prices are going down, you really want to be stuck on a house that's going down on value, right? So that's where the options are valuable, where you can put an option price on there and you can even say like, whenever you exercise the option, it's whatever the appraised value is. Or you can do a step down on the price. Like this year it's this, and if the prices are going down, it's, you can make it lower. So it's so flexible on all the different things you can do. Jack Miller, that's who it was.
Okay. I remember.
Yeah, so he also, there's just a bunch of different strategies. depending on what you want to do. But the lease purchase, the reason why I'm always gravitated to that thought is because the risk is so low. Like, so low, you don't want to be stuck, you know?
It's the safest way. I have a little mind map here. I'll show this with you guys really quickly. If anyone wants it, just I'll post it in the Skype group. Basically, your contracts are real summarization here. You got to learn your strategies. There's multiple strategies that you can do in a lease purchase. Your own home, you can sandwich lease. That's you rent someone's home for 3 years, you lock in the purchase price, you lock in the rent, and then you sublet or sandwich. They call it a sandwich because it's a three-party deal. I usually make the joke, I'm the bologna between two slices of white bread. Okay. You can take a contract, a lease purchase contract, and you can sell it to another investor. If you need cash, you're a little short on money right now, sell it to another investor and just step out of it. Let them do the repairs, let them do the marketing and everything. Sometimes if you're a good finder, this is a great strategy. If you are good at finding deals and you want to make major money, you can do retail assignments to families that need a home but want an opportunity, and they have to, and you qualify them very quickly up front by, do they have option money? Okay, are they employed? Can they afford the monthly payments? And you've got to substantiate that, do they have readily available option money? Option money can be anywhere, in my opinion, from 2.5% to 10% of the sale price of the property. It's negotiable. This is where you make an upfront profit on someone else's profit. You get really good at lease purchasing. You read everything, you study everything, you do a few deals, you start consulting on it. I have a very successful, and I'm picking up business right now. Right, all of a sudden, I'm getting calls on consultation for lease purchasing because I have books and videos out there. I've done for years a lot of pre-marketing. All of a sudden, people are starting to go to the search engines and type in lease purchase, lease option, rent to own. And my name is coming up from all the videos and stuff I did on YouTube. I'm getting consultation fees now on deals. You can cooperate on the deal with an owner. You can go to an owner and say, Mr. and Mrs. Owner, why don't you set up a lease purchase? I can work with you. I'll charge a consulting fee, or we can be joint venture partners or something like that. You can do a pure option, which is just this is great. Henry might talk about this for a second. Henry, do you use options in land?
Absolutely. I mean, that's one of the main things that I do for land. There's a lot of different ways that you can structure, especially when it's what they consider a non-owner occupied. So there's a lot more flexibility with regulations and stuff like that to do for optioning on land and stuff.
Yeah. What do you, Henry, you and I, we've been around the block once or twice. It's not our first rodeo. Tell everybody what you live in Fresno, which is the gateway to the Sequoia National Park or something like that, right? Yeah,
that's one of them. Yosemite's a national, probably
Yep.
Gorgeous.
Yep. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful.
Congress just passed like $180 million plan to plant more sequoias or something. Oh, wow. They're these gigantic trees. You can drive your cars through them and stuff. Henry, tell everybody what happened in Fresno in the 2007-8-9 period.
Well, during that time, I mean, obviously it affected everybody, but yeah, especially in the Fresno area, I mean, we saw a drastic drop in a lot of the houses and stuff like that. I mean, probably about 20, 30, 40%, I seen some of the drops there in Fresno, back in 07 and 08, during that time. And that was probably the last time I still do some deals there, but most of the stuff I do is still outside of California. But that was an opportunity there to pick up homes, especially Las Vegas. Las Vegas was another one that I was picking up lots there in North Las Vegas. And you're not going to believe this, for $600 a lot that were ready to go to be built.
And what do they go for today?
Oh, at least 40, 50, 60,000 now. I mean, easily, but they're already built on. I mean, so those are just some of the opportunities that happened back then.
And are you getting that buzz on the back of your neck like I am, the hair standing up? Are you getting that 2007-8 feeling right now again?
I probably not so much because I think it's a little bit different. But what I am seeing is a lot more opportunity, definitely, to do a lot more creative financing. Which opens up a huge, huge opportunity to take advantage of it. So, you know, I think we probably have this window of about maybe a year or two, you know, basically to be able to take advantage of it. That's why I say go back to some of your old leads. You know, if you had some individuals who weren't willing to sell, they're going to be a lot more flexible now.
Good point. Brandon, did they talk a little bit about marketing? Where do you find these deals as the market is changing?
So what's interesting is wholesalers, they already do a ton of marketing. They do a ton of cold calling. They pull a lot of data lists. They do texting, depending on the state. They'll do a lot of PPC. That's a big thing. A lot of them are set up with Google pay-per-click and Facebook ads, where they're doing online leads now, and they're doing nationwide. A lot of these wholesalers are doing nationwide leads. But what's interesting, let's say we're in a room of 100 people, Claude, yeah, maybe 3 to 5 people know creative out of all that. I mean, I'm talking about like 7-figure companies. None of them are doing creative. I've consulted for some of the biggest wholesalers here in Phoenix and trained their entire teams on just some simple strategies that they've implemented. And it monetizes their leads. It helps them get deals. I've done JV deals with them. So you can become like the designated hitter, like my buddy Eddie Speed talks about. You can become the designated hitter in your city, in your area, if you can help them work their leads too.
So you should, I'm taking away that you should really target market. If you live in a Chicago, a New York, a Newark, a LA, you should really target market your backyard.
This can be done virtually, Claude. I mean, you think about all the people you work with. You do stuff with people all over the nation. So I wouldn't even limit yourself to that.
Okay, but a starting investor, someone who's just getting, this is their first economic turmoil for real. And this is an opportunity. You're going to hear a lot of doom and gloom. We talked about that 2 weeks ago. I was driving through. You're going to hear a lot of how many people here are getting sick of listening to the news? Okay, all that stuff, you know, it gets a little depressing after a while. And when you're going to, during these recessionary periods, you hear a lot of doom and gloom. You're going to hear foreclosures. Oh, we didn't even talk about this. What about foreclosures? Yeah. Are we going to start? What's going to happen there? Who's got some, what did you hear about that? Anything?
They're coming back. They're already. So one of my good friends, Spencer Caldwell, he has a bidding service here in Phoenix, and he's like, they're actually coming back now. And even though people have equity, they still go through foreclosure because they think that they're going to have a Hail Mary or some family member is going to give them some money at the last minute. Mm-hmm. So one of the little tidbits I found out, so there's something called a notice of default that goes out, right? That's basically, or a list pendants, depending on your state, what's going on. Basically, it's the notice saying like they're starting the foreclosure process. In Phoenix, it's like 91 days, but there's something called, Henry may be able to help me with the exact verbiage, but I think it's like request to change trustee or something like that. So a lot of the banks will do that request first before they send out that notice of default.
Substitute trustee.
What was it? Substitution of trustee. Substitution of trustee.
Substitution,
Could you explain that? Could you explain that a little?
That's an amazing little head. So tell them about that, Steve.
Well, I think the biggest thing what we got to do is make sure we find, be the first one on the block. What I've learned is be the first person on the block and get there before everybody else. So if you can do that, you know, I going back to seller financing, I bought some land through a seller financing. The guy wanted all cash, so I did creative financing on it. And I closed them and I had 5 lots, and we've got 4 lots sold with another one's coming up in another week. So once you find out where people are at, be there the first kid on the block. I remember Wayne Gretzky said, you know, I want to be there. I want to figure out where the puck's going to go, and I want to be the first one there. So if you can figure out where the puck's going, that's really the key, I believe, in this market. Because I think once they raise that 0.75% up, it's going to go. And I think it's going to really slow down. Brandon's in Phoenix. I'm in Phoenix. I do work in Pinal County. My key is get there first. Find out how you get there first. Be the first.
And that's one of the ways to do it, Claude, is that if you can figure out how to get on that substitution of it's called substitution of trustee.
Yep, substitution of trustee.
That means before they send out the foreclosure, they do that. So you can be there before they get the foreclosure notice.
And then give them a call. Use the Gus video. Give them a call and they go, you know, have a little bit of pattern interrupt in the beginning. They go, I didn't know I was in foreclosure. But you got to be very careful how you word that, so you don't want to let them know that. Okay. So you got to use a lot of good the proper words with the people. That's a great way to get some leads. Yeah.
Go ahead, Chris.
No, I was just joking. I said, you got a big problem, sir.
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah, that works, man.
Yeah. What do you mean I have a big problem? Let's do a quick role play. Got to do one role play at least.
Always Chris, too.
Who are you? Yeah. What do you mean I got a big problem?
I'm sorry.
I got a new puppy here who's peeing all over my new white carpet. What do you mean I got a problem?
Well, sir,
that was in honor of Brandon's new dog.
With all due respect, sir, are you aware that your property, the notice of substitute trustee was just sent out, meaning the bank is about to foreclose in the next 30 to 60 days? Just curious, sir.
I don't know about that stuff. I don't understand it.
Let me ask you, have you got any notices in the mail, sir, about your house being foreclosed on or being delinquent in payments or anything like that?
Yeah, but I just shred them. I haven't even paid my kids' college loans. Nobody cares.
So do you want me to tell you the truth or you want me to lie to you, sir? Blow hot air.
I don't even, truth, I guess.
Sir, you got a big problem. You're going to lose that house in the next 60 days or so if you don't make a decision of whether or not you want to keep it or stay in it. Now, I run a foreclosure rescue. I can help you with that. How would you feel if someone stepped in to help you with your situation, sir?
Throw in the imagine for a moment we deal with this problem and we resolve it or find a better solution. Throw in a little imagery in here.
Gotcha. Imagine for a second, sir, that we deal with this problem, we get it behind you, it's out of your hands. Maybe you keep the property if that's what you want, you can afford it, or maybe you get all your equity out of the property and you're able to move on to the next phase of your life.
Yeah, can you do that for me? What are you, a lawyer or something?
Sir, I can't do that for you. I've been doing this for a long time now. I'm not a lawyer, but I am an investor, and I help hundreds of people just like you every
year. Throw in the word consultant, too. That has a nice, that's a nice word.
Definitely.
Sometimes when we say I'm an investor and they've received too many phone calls, does the word investor have a negative connotation to it sometimes?
Yes.
You might want to use the word consultant.
Businessman.
Gotcha.
Okay.
I like that. Consultant.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for that. It was good role play. That's get in the door. Let them know their problem. Paint a picture and then offer solutions to them. Bring them into the circle. Don't push them out with some kind of scripted nonsense stuff. One point I made a note here. One of the things we talked about this 2 weeks ago, what do large companies that are not making profits like they used to, what do they do? What's the first thing they do to their employees?
Lay off.
They lay them off. We see the unemployed. Has anyone got the, Brandon, maybe, did they talk about, I haven't watched, this is my negligence. What's the unemployment stats right now? Are they going up?
They didn't talk about that, but unemployment's actually, there's a lot of places still hiring, but you pay attention to the big employers in the cities. And if they start laying off, for example, all the mortgage companies have already laid off a ton of people.
Okay. Why are there so many, why is there not enough people working though? It seems like everywhere needs, the airlines, they can't get anyone to work. Why is that?
I think if we had the answer to that, I would get the, Nobel Prize for economic reasoning right now. I think we're going through a cultural shift that's a result of the pandemic and stimulus checks. And maybe I'm way off here, but I don't understand if Wendy's is, who said it, Steve, $20 an hour to run a French fry machine? That's nuts.
Yeah.